Good morning, church.
Morning.
We serve a good God, yes?
Amen.
I know I say that every week, but I still am overwhelmed by how good our God is and how powerful he is to save. Please stand and join us today as we worship the Lord through song.
Say this mountain can be moved. Oh, they say these chains will never break. Oh, but they don't know you like we do. There is power in your name. We've heard that there is no way. We've heard the tide will never change. They haven't seen what you can do. There is power in your name. So much power in your name. Move the immovable. Break the unbreakable. God, we believe. God, we believe for it. From the impossible, we'll see a miracle. God, we believe. God, we believe for it. Know that hope is never lost. Oh, for there is still an empty grave. God, we believe no matter what. There is power in your name. So much power. Break the unbreakable. God, we believe. God, we believe for it. From the impossible, we'll see a miracle. God, we believe. God, we believe for it. Seems to be no way. We trust in you, God. You have the final say. You are the way when there seems to be no way. We trust in you, God. You have the final say. The immovable, break the unbreakable. God, we believe. God, we believe for it. From the impossible, we see a miracle. God, we believe. God, we believe for it. From the immovable, break the unbreakable. God, we believe. God, we believe. For it from the impossible, we'll see a miracle. God, we believe. God, we believe for
faithfulness, O God, my Father, there is no shadow.
We had to lay off our furniture movers this week, so it's me. Thank you, Mike, for laughing at that. All right. Hey, welcome to First Covenant Church and Encouragement Kingdom Outreach this morning. We're delighted that you're here. I'm Pastor Evan. That's Pastor John. You're going to hear from both of us today. A little shorter than usual as far as what we're bringing, but we're bringing the word of the Lord from the same passage in just a moment. And I want to start by just pointing out that there's a lot of excitement I have about this morning. I hope you have it too, because it was a little over three years ago that we started what was a partnership, but it maybe didn't look like it in a sense. Because when Pastor John and I discussed using the space for Encouragement Kingdom Outreach as they got going, we had a dream of being able to do things together from time to time, worshiping together, sometimes doing ministry. And sometimes that's really worked and sometimes it hasn't, but we've always had that dream and that prayer that in fact God could bring us together in ministry much more often. So we're not just worshiping in the same building, but doing ministry together as much as we can possibly, still being our own entities in that way. And so it's really fun that I know we had to shift things. I know that came with some adjustments. And by the way, especially for those from First Covenant, if you're not on the e-news right now, some of you are surprised. Get on the e-news so that you're not surprised in the future by things like this, but we're glad that everybody's here. I do want to say one nuts and bolts thing. We will take an offering in a little bit. There are envelopes in your pews if you are giving offering this morning, and there are pens as well. If you are giving, please write which church you're giving to, EKO or First Cov. You can write it either way, but that's why we provided the envelopes, if that way we can keep things together. If you just put it in there, we're just going to split it between the two of us, and it'll go towards both ministries. There is a potluck after church today as well. Everybody's invited downstairs for the potluck after this. It's a brunch potluck, so we'll see what kind of fun things people brought. But please join us. Stick around for that part. One last thing I wanted to say before I read our scripture for today is that kind of in the life of the church, this is a First Covenant side thing, but I just want to make sure that you're aware that Sunday school begins next week. And this is beyond First Covenant, but the worship leader workshop for Lincoln area that Garrett has been putting on through First Covenant is in a couple weeks. And if you want to help with that, please let Garrett know. We need a few more people that could help with that. With that in mind, I'd like to go ahead and read our text for both messages this morning. It comes from 1 Kings chapter 17, verses 7 through 24. And here we have Elijah and the widow and her son. Sometime later, the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. Then the word of the Lord came to him, "Go at once to Zarephath in the region of Sidon and stay there. I have directed a widow there to supply you with food." So he went to Zarephath. When he came to the town gate, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called to her and asked, "Would you please bring me a little water in a jar so I may have a drink?" As she was going to get it, he called, "And bring me, please, a piece of bread." "As surely as the Lord your God lives," she replied, "I don't have any bread, only a handful of flour in a jar and a little olive oil in a jug. I'm gathering a few sticks to take home and make a meal for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die." Elijah said to her, "Don't be afraid. Go home and do as you have said. But first make a small loaf of bread for me from what you have and bring it to me. And then make something for yourself and your son. For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says: the jar of flour will not be used up and the jug of oil will not run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on the land." She went away and did as Elijah had told her. So there was food every day for Elijah and for the woman and her family. For the jar of flour was not used up, and the jug of oil did not run dry, in keeping with the word of the Lord spoken by Elijah. Sometime later, the son of the woman who owned the house became ill. He grew worse and worse and finally stopped breathing. She said to Elijah, "What do you have against me, man of God? Did you come to remind me of my sin and kill my son?" "Give me your son," Elijah replied. He took him from her arms, carried him to the upper room where he was staying, and laid him on his bed. Then he cried out to the Lord, "Lord my God, have you brought tragedy even on this widow I am staying with by causing her son to die?" Then he stretched himself out on the boy three times and cried out to the Lord, "Lord my God, let this boy's life return to him." The Lord heard Elijah's cry, and the boy's life returned to him, and he lived. Elijah picked up the child and carried him down to the room into the house. He gave him to his mother and said, "Look, your son is alive." Then the woman said to Elijah, "Now I know that you are a man of God and that the word of the Lord from your mouth is the truth." This is the word of the Lord. As I looked at that this week, I think it's easy to look at the widow particularly, and it's easy to understand what it takes to lose faith when the brook runs dry. And my guess is that we have a witness in the house, many of moments where you felt dry or you felt lost. I can attest to it myself. And I was struck with the question then as I look at this text, how can trust in God be increased even in dry times? How can it be increased even in dry times, which is what seems to happen, actually, in the text? And so I thought of four things that I saw in the text that stand out. The first one seems counterintuitive of how can trust in God increase even in dry times, and that is, you can still be generous even when times are tough. Because that's what the widow actually is. She's generous even though she's going through a tough time. For Elijah, you can see that the text starts with the word that the brook dried up. Elijah had just gone to King Ahab. He had just given a word to King Ahab. There's going to be no rain. It's because of your unfaithfulness to the Lord. And then God delivers Elijah out into the wilderness away from King Ahab, where the ravens come and feed him, and the brook is there to water him. But then where does our text start? Then the brook dried up. So even Elijah has to rely on the Lord now in a different way. But we can look at the widow and we can recognize that for the widow, the brook, if you will, dried up a long time ago. She lost her husband. It's now just her and her son in dry times. And you can see in verse 12, it says, as surely as the Lord your God lives. And you can catch a few things from her own words that she delivers to Elijah about where she's feeling at this time, about how dry she is. She's not lost belief that God exists, but she seems to be a little bit distant from God at this time. And you can see later in the text, she even thinks she might be the problem. The brook ran dry for her. And yet, in the midst of that, she still demonstrates trust by providing for Elijah, even when she has very little. You can still be generous even when times are tough. Second thing I noticed in the text about how can we trust in God and how can that be increased when times are dry is that Elijah demonstrates this well. Talking to God is better than talking about God. Talking to God is better than talking about God because God had provided in this time of drought and in this time of famine. And it's interesting that they thought they had made it. They had this abundance of oil, the abundance of flour. They were able to eat. They were able to drink. And then the sun dies. They thought they had made it. And then the sun dies. And what does Elijah do? Even Elijah has a moment of doubt. Even Elijah has this moment of pause. God, have you done it now? Why now did this thing happen? Why now did tragedy strike? But if you notice, in his difficulty, in his doubt, in his struggle, he talks to God. He doesn't go to everybody else and talk about God and never address God. And some people do that in their times of struggle. Why did God do this? But they never address God directly. They go to everybody else in their life and complain about what's happened, and maybe God has something to do with it, but they don't directly talk to God. What does Elijah do? He talks to God. Why does he talk to God? I mean, we all have these moments of doubt and loss and struggle and grief, but why does he go to God? Well, the answer that I saw could be picked up in a lot of places, but Psalm 139 came to mind, and I want to read an extended portion of it for you. Psalm 139 says, where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for the darkness is as light to you. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body all the days ordained for me, written in your book before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast is the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. When I awake, I am still with you. If only you, God, would slay the wicked. Away from me, you who are bloodthirsty. They speak of you with evil intent. Your adversaries misuse your name. Do I not hate those who hate you, Lord, and abhor those who are in rebellion against you? I have nothing but hatred for them. I count them my enemies. Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me to the way everlasting. We take them to God, our issues, even in dry times, because nobody else can deliver on that. Nobody else knows us, and nobody else can lead us to the way everlasting. Only God can. Only God gets it. Third thing, how can trust in God be increased in dry times that we see from the text here is that God speaks and directs even when it seems like he's silent. The brook God provided ran dry. And Elijah could easily then look at God and say, what's going on? I thought you said you were going to provide in these dry times. Why now did the brook run dry, God? And the widow, she's ready to die, but God had different plans for her too. And it doesn't seem like he's speaking directly, but God is directing everything that's going on here. And it's often the case that God uses our circumstances to move us towards his will and way And quite often those are tough circumstances that direct us the most. If Elijah didn't arrive, or if the brook didn't run dry, Elijah wouldn't have moved to the widow. If Elijah didn't arrive, the woman and her son would have died. When the son died, if Elijah wasn't there, this woman would have maintained her low self-esteem in God. And it struck me then with this question, if we're talking about this in the terms of in the text, how do we make this personal? Where does God need to move in your own life today to revive your spirit? Where does God need to move in your life right now because you feel dry and he's moving in the background, but you need to see it? God speaks and directs even when it seems like he's silent. And the fourth thing I noticed in the text when it comes to God and increasing our trust in dry times is that we should trust in God's character, not in his benefits. Because the incident with the widow, interestingly, took place in a place called Zarephath in Sidon. That is just outside King Ahab's territory. Elijah went to King Ahab. Where did God deliver him? Outside of his territory, so he could be safe. But it's still hit by the drought. It's still suffering from a lack of water. This area that Elijah is now in with this widow is a place that's also a hotbed of idolatry. They worship Baal and Asherah. And this widow who believes is the underdog in that territory. People in that area would put their faith in whatever benefited them for that day, from whatever God they wanted to choose. Today, Baal, tomorrow, Asherah. Maybe we'll try Yahweh on Thursday. Whichever one gives me the thing I want is the one I'm going to go to. There's no trust in the character of God, just in the stuff I might be able to get that'll give me some crumbs for the day. And the widow, she thought she was the problem in all of this too, if you notice. Elijah, did you come here just to point out my sin? She's kind of trying to hide this stuff from God too. She's hiding in a corner. And her focus is kind of like that. Her focus is in surviving in God's world, not thriving with God in his world. And it pointed me to a similar moment that happens in the New Testament with Jesus. And we'll end with this moment. I won't unpack much of it other than a woman who's also an outsider in the New Testament comes to Jesus, and her daughter's possessed by a demon. She comes to Jesus because she knows he can do something. And in Mark chapter 7, Jesus looks at her and he says, "First let the children eat all they want," he told her, "for it is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs." "Lord," she replied, "even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." Then he told her, "For such a reply you may go, the demon has left your daughter." She went home and found her child lying on the bed and the demon gone. The woman who shouldn't get it in this story with Jesus gets it. She knows Jesus can deliver, just like you read in the psalm. She wants peace in her home. Jesus honors her and delivers real food rather than crumbs. He delivers something that will provide thriving rather than just surviving. And that's exactly what God is doing with the widow, with Elijah, with the son in the story we read this morning. God offers the same to them. He offers the same to you and me through Jesus. The message in both these stories, the message to us, even in dry times, is that you are redeemable and God cares. And we need to trust him and his character, not just the things that he might provide today. Because that's thriving with God. Where are you just surviving today when you could be thriving with God? Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for the ways that you deliver, you care, you consider us redeemable. Thank you, God, for your goodness towards us, your continued care. We lift up these words. We lift up the words to come. We lift up the offering. We'll take in a little bit all to you. Pray this all in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen.
Please stand as we continue to sing.
Be still, my soul. The Lord is on your side. Bear patiently the cross of grief or pain. leave to your God to order and provide. In every change, He faithful will remain. Be still, my soul, your best, your heavenly friend. Through thorny ways leads to a joyful end. Be still, my soul, your God will undertake to guide the future as He has the past. Your hope, your confidence, let nothing shake. All now mysterious shall be bright at last. Be still, my soul, the waves and winds still know His voice to be still, my soul, the hour is hastening on, when He shall be forever with the Lord. When disappointment, grief, and fear are gone, sorrow for God, love cures, joys restore. Be still, my soul, when change and tears are past, all safe and blessed we shall meet at last. All safe and
good morning, church. My name is Charlene Harris, and I am in love with this man, Pastor John Harris, for 38 years. And I'm excited that we're here this morning. As Pastor Evan said, this is what the church is supposed to be like. We are part of the international church, and God is pleased. And I'm so glad that we're here with you today. And as we come together and fellowship, because that's that one more step, right? We are sharing the building, we're sharing a service, and now we're sharing a meal. God wants to continue to break us, to be able to use us in a way that can touch so many others here in Lincoln, Nebraska. Yeah. And then in Lincoln, then the state of Nebraska, the United States, and the world. Amen. We are so glad to see those who are from Encouragement Kingdom Outreach Fellowship and First Covenant. Amen. So join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, I just am so thankful, Lord Jesus, for what you're doing in this place. Amen. I thank you that you are our Father God. And Lord, you sit above the whole earth, Lord. We can come to you, Lord Jesus, from our place, Lord Jesus, from our emptiness, Father God, our dryness, Father God, our hurting place, Lord Jesus, and tired and weary, Lord. And Lord, we can come to you with praise and honor and worship this morning. And I thank you, Jesus, for us to be able to gather together in your name, Lord. You are the one that brings us together, Lord. I thank you for the songs of worship this morning, Lord, to open our hearts, Lord Jesus, to receive your word, Lord. And we have received that word, Lord Jesus, that you are here to fill us, even in dry times, Lord. We can trust in you, Lord. You will provide for us, Father God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Jesus, that we can rest in assurance that you care for us, Lord. And I thank you for the second part of the word, Lord, that will come forth. That food that will feed us, Lord, that will give us what we need to go into this week, Lord. I thank you for each heart, Lord, that's here and represented. Those who had the heart to be here and unable to attend, Lord. That you would just continue to meet us where we're at, Lord. May we continue to talk with you, Father God. May we continue to fellowship with you and one another, Lord Jesus, to do what only you can do in us, Lord. I thank you that you know me, Lord Jesus. You see me. You know the words before I even speak them, Lord. And so, Lord, that I would get out of the way and each of us would get out of the way, Lord, that you can come forth, Lord Jesus, and shine through us, Lord. We love you today, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, for all the places where we wish it was something different going on in our lives and in our jobs and in our space and in our neighborhood, Lord, and even in our church, Lord Jesus. We ask that you would touch the brokenhearted today, Lord, those grieving families, Lord Jesus. We pray that you would just continue to comfort, Lord, and that we would continue to be the body of Christ, Lord, that will reach out and to touch, to call, to pray for, Lord, to send a plant, just to sit, Lord. We pray for those who have pain in their bodies and in their minds, Lord Jesus, in their soul and their spirit, Lord Jesus, that only you can touch, Lord, and comfort them as well, Lord. Lord, I thank you for their enduring strength and power that just continues to keep them rising day after day after day, Lord. You know, Lord, and I thank you for that, Lord. I thank you, Lord Jesus, for the prayers that you've answered, Father God, and those you have yet to answer, Lord Jesus, that you know us, Lord. You want to be in fellowship with us, Lord, that we will continue to do what you have asked us to do, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Our world is filled with wars and rumors of wars, Lord Jesus, and we're in that period where people, innocent people, are dying, Lord, and you know where they are, Lord. Help us to be the body of Christ that continues to reach out to you, Lord, that continues to lay down our sins before you, Lord, and ask for you to change our hearts, Lord, of our nation, Lord. Lord, we love you today, Lord Jesus, and I thank you for the tithes and offering that will come forth, Lord, that we will continue to bring into the storehouse the blessings that you can continue to pour out your blessings on us, Lord. I thank you, Lord Jesus, again, Lord, and love you, and I thank you for the word that will continue to come forth and the work that you're doing in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
This time we'd like to invite our ushers down to collect the offering. And to remind you, those envelopes are in front of you on the pew. And if you'd like to designate the money for any particular church, you can write the name of the church on the envelope. Otherwise, it'll just be split between both churches. Let us worship.
Before I knew my name, before I drew a breath, he was making ways for me. Now and every day, in each and every step, he was making ways for me. When my heart is full of doubt, feels like fate is running out, I'm too far to turn around. I know God will work it out. God will work it out. One thing I know, one thing I've found. God will work it out.
God will work it out. Do I have one witness in here today? Woo, Jesus. Come on, give the Lord a hand, praise. Woo. Will he do it? Yes, he will. I'm so grateful for this morning. I'm not going to hold it together. I know I'm not going to do it. But when we prayed about an in-person service, when we started Kingdom Outreach in my basement in November of 2020, there were people asking, Pastor, when is there going to be an in-person service? And I didn't know that there would be. But we prayed and we said, Lord, tell us which way to go and how to go and where to go. And Evan and I met in a committee, and we met at this church, I think in that room over there. And I said, you know, I didn't want it to be just a place where we were leasing or renting or whatever, but we had a true partnership in ministry where we indeed were the family of God together. And as Evan said, we are journeying and efforting, if you will, intentionally to try to make that more and more true every time. And so I'm grateful today. With food on our minds, I'm gonna jump right in. Can I do that? Praise God, amen. I know I got some witnesses over here on this side. When Evan told me about the direction we were going, I began to think about some questions. Some questions relative to the character of God. I want you to stay with me in these questions. The first was, why does God provide? Why does God provide? The second question was, what does God provide? The third was, when does God provide? And lastly, how does God provide? And so as I was thinking through the text, God answers all of those questions in our text of 1 Kings. Because as Evan said, here is the man of God, the prophet of God, Elijah. And you should know that the prophet often had two specific purposes. The first, of course, was to bring a message of encouragement to the people, if indeed that was what God wanted. That was his job, was to do what God wanted, to give the message that God had sent him to provide. And that message could be a message of encouragement. But on this situation, it was a message of warning and challenge because Ahab and Jezebel were in idolatry. They were disobedient, leading people in the wrong way. And so the prophet had to come with a message of woe and warning and a declaration that God would stop the rain, causing the land to be infertile. Nothing would grow. And so the prophet did his job. But the question then becomes, what does God do as Elijah does what he does? Well, God provides. God provides. He provides Elijah with a confirmation of the word that he gave to Ahab and to Jezebel. He didn't come speaking his own words. He came speaking the words that God gave him. He provides and demonstrates his authority, his sovereignty, and his power over the gods of Baal. Because the God who is God showed up and he showed out on Elijah's behalf. He kept the rain from the earth 3.5 years. But not only that, friends, he provides Elijah with the very sustenance that he needs by the brook. Not only the water, but the food from the ravens. Can you imagine being fed by birds? They have small beaks. How much food could they bring? I'm trying to get some Jimmy John's, and you bringing me twigs. And say, what are you doing? What are you doing? Can we get some Famous Dave's up in here? God provides for Elijah in a miraculous way. Anybody here still believe that God can provide in a miraculous way? Huh? Providing for his needs once, twice, again and again. And then, as Evan said, then he throws the widow in. Puts the widow in there. And God provides once again, not only for that one moment where Elijah says, how about some bread for me? But not only bread for me, bread for you that will not run dry. And then God provides a response to the prayer to raise up the son who was dead. God is in the providing business. It's not what he is, it's who he is. So we go back to the questions again. Why does God provide? Well, he provides out of his love and out of his compassion. Huh? We just need only read probably the most familiar verse that we know, John 3:16. God so loved, and because he so loved, he did what? He gave. He gave. And here's an old saying from the old saints back in the day. If God never does another thing for you, he's already done enough. Huh? So many people in this political time are worried about what this is and what that is. Listen, we say God bless America. Maybe the challenge is God has already blessed America. Maybe blessed America too much. When we look in our closets and when we look in our cupboards, we got more stuff than anybody in the world. Even the poor of us, poorest among us, are the richest among us, among others in the world. God has blessed us. What does God provide? God provides whatever we need. When we say, I sent out a message the other day. I was playing tennis Tuesday, and one of our players sneezed. And the guy said, what do you say when people sneeze? Bless you. And I said, do you know what you're really saying? You're saying, bless you. because he sneezed. What are we saying when we say bless you? We're asking God to provide his provision, his power, his peace, his protection upon another. Not in the old wives' tale where we think an evil spirit is coming out. But when we levy a blessing on someone, we're asking God to do something for this person, likely whether they deserve it or not. We're seeking God in that regard. So God provides whatever we need. Here's the problem with that, though. Does he always provide it the way we want it? And here's a newsflash. Does he provide it when we want it all the time? See? God doesn't work on our timetable. That's the challenge we have. When does God provide? He provides whenever he's ready. And what's our prayer? God, give me the endurance and the patience as you work your work out on my behalf. What are you doing in me while I'm waiting for the breakthrough? What are you doing in me while I'm waiting for that thing that I've prayed for? Give me your patience. Give me your peace. And how does God provide? Well, we saw it here in the text in a miraculous way. And what great thing about what God does, God provides in a way where we can take no credit for what he provides. Hello? No credit. And I'm a witness to that today. This very gathering is a gathering not of my own doing. It's a prayer of obedience. It's a prayer of faith. But God did this. He did this. And Pastor John, how are you going to build this church? It's not my job to build a church. Jesus says, I'll build a church. He'll bring to us who he wants, and he'll take away those he don't want. Praise you, Jesus. He'll open the doors for those who should come in, and he'll close the doors for those who shouldn't. Because we ain't got time for foolishness. We got to be about the Father's business. Thank you, Jesus. And so as we look to God as our provider, one of the challenges we have, my brothers and sisters, is this. And again, there's some naysayers out there. Those young people call them haters. There's some haters out there. If you're so big and bad, you Christians, and you say you trust God, why are you trusting in your IRA? Why are you trusting in SSI? Why are you trusting in your disability or your retirement? Can't God take care of you? Huh? Well, God, we trust God, but we ain't supposed to be fools. Now, hold on now. We trust God. We work for that. Let me backtrack for a minute. Give you a little bit more food. Did I say food again? I need to stop saying food. We pray the prayer that Jesus gives us. You can look at it in Luke chapter 11. And we pray that prayer that's most familiar. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. First, our focus and our attention is to God. Amen? And then his kingdom. Thy kingdom come and thy will be done. And the challenge, friends, is not to expect that kingdom to come in some esoteric, abstract way, but allow that kingdom to come right here. Right here. Allow God, allow yourself to be the conduit, the vehicle, the vessel through which God's blessing flows. Jesus in, Jesus out. Amen? And then the prayer is now our focus. Give us this day. Or some would say, give us each day. Give us day by day our daily bread. That's what Elijah asked for. Can you just make me some bread? Why bread? Because bread fills us up. Some of us have stopped eating bread because it fills us up. Huh? It fills us up. And so first time somebody gets on a diet, a low-carb diet, they say, well, you're looking good. What happened? I stopped eating bread. I'm not there yet. I love peanut butter and jelly. But bread is not necessarily what we're asking for when we say give us our diet. The prayer is give us the stuff we need to sustain us. Bread is just a part of that metaphor. Sometimes it's bread, but sometimes it's something else. And we trust God to provide. It's not just a request that we're making. It's an affirmation that when we pray, give us what we need, God can do it. Huh? Abraham said, the Bible says, Paul says in Romans 4:21, that Abraham believed that what God had promised, that God was faithful to perform. Is that the confidence you have in the provision of God today? That what God has promised, he is faithful to perform. Now, how does he perform it? Well, God can rain down blessings from heaven like he did manna for those who were in the wilderness. Or he could say, you know what, First Covenant and EKO? I want to show the blessing of God. I want to know the show the reality of God. I want to show the provision of God through the people of God. Now, some of you know that I'm a button maker. Some of you have taken advantage of some of the buttons that I've put out. And one of my favorite buttons to put out is the button I'm wearing today. Blessed to be a blessing. Blessed to be a blessing. And so what am I saying here? I'm saying what Malachi chapter 3:10 says. It makes reference to bringing your tithe, bring everything into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house, in the place where people are. See, as Christians, we may think we need the United Way and all these other things. You know what we need? We need a church of people willing to give. Huh? There should be no need in here among the body of Christ. If you need food, it should be here. If you need clothes, it should be here. It should be among us, the place where people are provided for. Let me take you to another quick passage before we're done. Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 and 4. This is to the body of Christ that Paul says this. Let nothing be done out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. He's talking to church folks now. But in humility, count others more significant than yourselves. Isn't that something? Think about other people, not just yourself. So what God has provided for you isn't just for you. All the stuff we have in our cupboards. You got more than 2 cans of food? You got more than 2 shirts, 2 pairs of pants, two pairs of shoes? What are you doing with that stuff? Is it for a yard sale or is it for somebody in need? God, help us today. Let nothing be done, but in humility, count others more significant than ourselves. And then he says, let each of you, this is what Paul says to these Philippian believers, let each of you look out not only for your own interests, but for the interests of others. And so we become the conduit of blessing to others. And God says, yes, I want to provide. But guess what? I want to provide through my people. Is that what you're thinking about today? For all that God models for us, one of the great things he models for us is his provision, his ability to give, to serve, to help. And so when we say, what does God exemplify in his character? Well, we can say that God is love. Amen? He's holy. He's gracious. He's merciful. He's compassionate. We could go on and on about the character of God, but the one thing I'm here to tell you today is that God is a giver. He's a provider. And what has he provided most of all? Well, he's provided his son. He's provided his son so that he might change our lives. And for that one who needs a new way, Jesus has come for that. For that one who needs a new truth, Jesus has come for that. And for that one who needs a new way, new life, Jesus has come for that. And so as we consider today the very character of God as a provider, as a giver, I'm here to tell you that what God has promised, he's faithful to perform. He shows that today in Elijah, bringing the widow's son back to life, giving her back her very son to say that for all that you're worried about, and I'm here to say to somebody, another passage, part of the passage in Philippians 2, be anxious for nothing. Huh? Stop worrying about who's going to be president. Stop worrying about who's going to get elected. Yeah, do your civic duty, but understand that God is still in charge. And whoever it is who gets to that White House, pray for him. Pray for her. Pray for them. Pray for these elected officials that somehow, some way, God might be present in their decisions. God might be present in their life. That they might understand that beyond what they can provide and that they offer the citizenry, like Ahab had to understand, there is a God in heaven and he is sovereign. There's another authority that you must look to. That's our message. That's who we look to. We trust in God. And as that song just said, God will make a way. Has he made a way in your life today? I pray he has. And if he has done that, I'm praying today that as you move to and fro, as you have your conversations, as you look across the landscape of the body of Christ in this place, whether you're Kingdom Outreach or whether you're First Covenant, look around and see those in need. Let me say this. One of the things God has gifted us to do is to be able to provide for our people. This is something I started through in my nonprofit, but we brought it into the church because people need help. These are Casey's gift cards. And as you give your tithe and your offering, whatever it is, every now and then, if you're at Casey's or a Super Saver, and I'm sure this church, like many other churches, get requests from time to time, pick up one of these and pass it to the office. You may have your own benevolence program, but somebody might need gas. Somebody might need food. So you're there buying your own stuff? Pick up a $10 card. Pick up a $20 card. Drop it off at the office and say, Pastor Evan, when somebody calls First Covenant in need, take care of them. Take care of them. Huh? This ain't rocket science, folks. This is just the easy stuff that God gives us to do. We're blessed to be a blessing. Would you pray with me this morning that God would help us as the band comes back, the musicians come back? See, God isn't interested in birthing a body of Christian hoarders. He's looking for people who recognize that everything they have is not their own. And everything you have is something that God can use, not only to bless you and your family, but to be a blessing, particularly in the body of Christ. Amen? Amen. Father God, we give you thanks and we give you praise for that which you have done and are doing in our lives. We thank you for the account of Elijah and all that you provided in that account. We thank you, Lord, that we can look to you as he did, to be sustained in the midst of challenge. Lord, we thank you for the word, for his obedience, to speak the word that you gave him, and then to wait and watch you work on his behalf. Thank you for the brook. Thank you for the ravens. Thank you for the widow. Thank you for your power and your presence in his life. And now, Lord, as we have learned and looked at that, we pray the same help today, that you would give us a sense of that same trust, that same obedience, that same faithfulness, to know that the God we serve is God. Oh, yes, we have those moments of anxiousness and anxiety, of worry, of concern. We're human. But I'm praying today for that one in our midst who continues to be worried about the cares of this world. Friend, understand that the God you serve is God. He knows where you are. He knows what you need. And better yet, he's brought you to a body of believers, I pray, who look beyond themselves to the needs of their family members and are more willing today than ever before to say, you know what? I'm blessed to be a blessing. I am saved to serve, to give as my heavenly Father gives. We thank you for Jesus Christ, who came, who lived, who died, and rose for our sins, to give us forgiveness and redemption and new life in him. Help us to not only talk the talk, but to walk the walk, that he might be glorified in our lives, and that the world may know that Jesus still saves. We love you, we thank you, and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
We Please stand and join us for one final song.
From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Come on and worship this morning.
All my life you have been faithful.
Say it, say it.
All my life you have been so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Hallelujah.
I love your voice.
I love your voice.
You have led me through the fire in the darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. Yes, you have, Lord. All my life you have been so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Running after me. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. My life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. All my life you have been faithful. Oh yes you have. All my life you have been so good. With every breath that I am able, oh I will sing of the goodness of God.
All my life.
Oh, all my life you have been faithful. Yes, you have. All my life you have been so good. With every breath that I am able, sing of the goodness of God. the goodness of God.
Thank you, Jesus. Your goodness runs after me, Lord. You led me through the fire. In the darkest night, you're like no other. Father, we thank you today for your goodness. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. Lord, as we prepare to partake of the food in just a moment, bless the food to our bodies. Let it nourish us and let it strengthen us. Let it help us to be more than we are when we walked in. Give us all the sustenance we need to be your people, to have the strength and the energy to do that which pleases you. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the sweet communion of his Spirit, may it rest, may it rule, and it abide with each one now and forevermore. And everyone said with me, amen. And amen. Come on, let's sing some more. All my life. Come on.
Your goodness
is running after. It's running after me. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down and surrender now, I give you everything. Running after me. All my life you have been faithful. Yes, you have been faithful, Lord. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, sing of the goodness of God.
One more time.
All my life you have been faithful. Yes, you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. Yeah. With every breath that I am able, I know I'm able, Lord.
I will sing
of the goodness of God. Yeah. I will sing of the goodness of God. Thank you, Jesus.
The way we end Encouragement Kingdom Hour, we say, hug somebody, love somebody, say it was good to see you this morning. Let's eat.